Welcome to NephroTube Online Nephrology Lectures. We are discussing the Oxford Handbook of Nephrology and Hypertension, second edition. In this lecture, we will discuss compartment syndrome, what nephrologists should know. All our lectures are present as PowerPoint at nephrotube.com, and video lectures in Arabic and language and English languages are available at our YouTube channel, NephroTube. Compartment syndrome, we have two major parts of compartment syndrome. One is related to skeletal muscles and the other is related to abdominal compartmental syndrome. Starting by compartment syndrome in muscles, that was mentioned in the part of rhabdomyolysis in Oxford Handbook. Compartment syndrome mainly means that there is increased in the pressure inside the muscle or inside any compartment. And here we are talking about skeletal muscles. How pressure inside the muscle may be increased when the muscle is injured in case of rhabdomyolysis. With muscle injury, there will be tissue swelling due to the injury, which will increase pressure. The swelling increases the pressure inside the muscle. Increased pressure will lead to decreased perfusion of the muscle, which will cause local hypoxia in the muscle. Hypoxia causes more cell damage. More cell damage cause more tissue swelling and so on. So increased compartmental pressure will cause hypoxia, which will cause tissue damage, tissue swelling, and so on. Another important point in rhabdomyolysis, as we mentioned in our lecture of rhabdomyolysis, that may cause compartmental syndrome in this patient is the rapid fluid resuscitation. Rapid fluid resuscitation in rhabdomyolysis patients may cause entry of large volume of fluid inside the muscle, causing increased compartmental pressure. And we have to suspect compartmental syndrome in rhabdomyolysis patient, as we mentioned in our lecture before, when the CK level is not going down day after day. It is maintained or elevated with treatment. So you have to suggest or think of compartmental syndrome or think of the presence of or the resistance of the muscle injury by any metabolic or viral cause. How compartmental syndrome present? By 5 P's: pain, pallor, pulse is declined or absent in the affected limb, paralysis, and paresthesia. Actually, pain is the dominant and most consistent symptom. The other signs and symptoms are rare. And sure, the muscle is fair modern on deep palpation. It is very hard. How to measure pressure inside the muscle? There is multiple apparatus used to measure the muscle by needle inserted in the muscle by different ways and different techniques. Finally, you diagnose compartment syndrome if the pressure of the muscle inside the muscle, in the compartment of the muscle, is more than 50 millimeter mercury in patients with normal blood pressure, or if intracompartment pressure is 30 to 50 millimeter mercury in hypotensive patients. Those are highly suggestive for intracompartment syndrome in these patients. How to treat? Start first by non-surgical techniques, but usually if the pressure inside the muscle is still very high, you may need emergency fasciectomy, fascia release, to decrease the pressure inside the muscle. What is the role of nephrologist in these cases in compartmental syndrome? Check the patient for the possibility of pre-renal impairment, for the possibility of acute tubular necrosis, and sure to treat rhabdomyolysis. And you can check our rhabdomyolysis lecture on YouTube and NephroTube, and you will find links of different lectures we discussed before at our website nephrotube.com. The second part of our lecture is the abdominal compartmental syndrome, increased abdominal pressure. Actually, we have two definitions: intra-abdominal hypertension and abdominal compartmental syndrome. Intra-abdominal hypertension is defined when the intra-abdominal pressure is more than 12 millimeter mercury. We have four grades according to different pressures. Acute compartmental syndrome, acute compartment syndrome, is said to be when intra-abdominal pressure is more than 20 millimeter mercury, starting from grade 3 intra-abdominal hypertension. So acute compartment syndrome is a part of intra-abdominal hypertension. But when the intra-abdominal pressure is more than 20 millimeter mercury. So intra-abdominal hypertension considered with intra-abdominal pressure more than 12. Abdominal compartment syndrome is considered when intra-abdominal pressure is more than 20 millimeter mercury. Incidence varies widely, mentioned in Oxford Handbook, from 1 to 15% of traumatic injury, and in different prevalence, in different trials and studies, it present with different incidence. What are the causes of acute compartment syndrome? What increases the pressure inside abdomen? Causes and classification is different between references, different references. In Oxford Handbook, they mention that primary acute compartmental syndrome, when injury or disease is within the abdomen, as trauma, surgery, ascites, as we mentioned in the lecture of hepatorenal syndrome, and so on, pancreatitis. And they said acute compartment syndrome is secondary when there is disease and injury from outside the abdomen, as sepsis, burn. In sepsis and burn, usually there is decreased capillary leak. And when there is aggressive fluid resuscitation, especially in sepsis and burn, this fluid will escape through the capillaries into the abdominal compartment and increases the abdominal pressure. But there is another classification for the acute compartment syndrome. They may classify acute compartment syndrome primary also and secondary, but this time primary if the cause is surgical or trauma, secondary if it is medical, as diminished abdominal wall compliance, increased intraluminal vesicle contents, urinary bladder, intestine, whatever, increased abdominal cavity contents and as case of ascites, and finally with high fluid resuscitation and capillary leak as in cases of sepsis and burn. So whatever the etiology or the shape of the classification, the concept is the same and the management is the same. Okay. What happens if there is a patient with increased intra-abdominal pressure? Actually, if there is increased abdominal pressure, inferior vena cava and vena cava will be compressed, which will decrease venous return to the heart and it will cause decrease in uric output. So there will be decreased venous return, decreased cardiac output, and sure, there will be decrease in chest compliance because the diaphragm is not freely mobile. And there will be GIT consequences because intra-abdominal pressure will decrease mesenteric flow, bowel ischemia, gut edema, which will associated with bacterial translocation and sepsis, and finally compression of the liver which causes lactic acidosis. What about the kidney? Yes, with increased intra-abdominal pressure, this will compress the renal veins, cause venous congestion, and again, in this patient, there is cardiac output. The cardiac output is decreased with decreased perfusion in the kidney and with decreased effective circulatory volume, which will cause activation of sympathetic adrenal angiotensin aldosterone system, causing more renal vasoconstriction. The same as happened in hepatorenal syndrome. So both of these will decrease renal perfusion, causing oliguria and acute kidney injury. So the end result regarding the renal part in patients with acute compartmental syndrome is decreased renal perfusion and acute kidney injury. And to treat this acute kidney injury, you have to decompress the abdominal pressure and decrease it to facilitate kidney perfusion. So according to the consequences we mentioned, the patient will present with abdominal pain and tenderness, difficulty in breathing, high pulse, low pressure, increased jugular venous pressure, decreased urine output, peripheral edema, and lactic acidosis. And this is logic from the consequences we described now. Okay, we have to come now to the most important point. Who are the patients who are at risk for the development of acute compartment syndrome? This is the list of the patients who are at risk for the development of intra-abdominal hypertension or acute compartment syndrome. Check this list. You will find almost all patients who are admitted in your ICU or surgical ward are at risk for abdominal compartment syndrome. And you have to put in mind and don't miss to diagnose acute compartment syndrome. As I mentioned later, it may be the key to treat, diagnose and treat acute kidney injury in some of these patients. So actually most of the patients with different pathological conditions are at risk for increased intra-abdominal pressure. Okay, so how to measure intra-abdominal pressure in these patients to diagnose intra-abdominal hypertension or acute compartment syndrome? Different ways are available. You can measure intra-abdominal pressure through bladder, through gastric, stomach, through rectum, vaginal, inferior vena cava, direct peritoneal. But the most commonly used method is through the urinary bladder. You measure the intravesical pressure, which transmits the intra-abdominal pressure. How to use it? Just use a Foley catheter. In these diagrams, they are depending on urine, but in Oxford and the most commonly used, we are depending on saline, as I will describe now. Empty the bladder of the patient, then inject in the Foley catheter not greater than 25 ml of saline. Then use the CVB marker, okay, and put its zero level at the symphysis pubis. Then check the level of the water. Again, you have to put about 25 ml of saline inside the urinary bladder. Connect your CVB monitor to the Foley catheter. Put its zero level at the level of symphysis pubis and check the fluid level of saline. Each 1 centimeter water in your CVB monitor is equal to 0.74 millimeter mercury. So you will convert centimeter water to millimeter mercury and know the intra-abdominal pressure through intravesical pressure. Okay, this is the way or the method to how to measure intravesical pressure. It's important to measure intra-abdominal pressure in patients who have non-risk factors, almost all our patients. And if the intra-abdominal pressure is more than 12, this means that the patient has intra-abdominal hypertension, you have to repeat the intra-abdominal intravesical pressure measuring every 4 hours for early diagnosis of acute compartment syndrome when intra-abdominal pressure is more than 20 millimeter mercury. How to manage this patient? Management is surgical and medical. Surgical recommended for acute compartment syndrome in traumatic and surgical patients who where the abdominal wall has already been violated, and even it may be needed in case of severe pancreatitis not responding to medical measures. Regarding medical management, it is important because it is easy and may improve the case. We see many cases in ICU with sepsis and oligoric patients, and the response to supportive measures is poor. That is because this patient may develop acute compartment syndrome and it is missed. So it is important to measure abdominal compartment syndrome in all ICU patients, even or especially in your acute kidney injury patients. Because if there is acute compartment syndrome and you treated it, you may resolve this acute kidney injury easily, or it may help you to resolve acute kidney injury beside the treatment of the original cause of the disease. How to medically manage acute compartment syndrome? Improve abdominal wall compliance by sedation analgesics, neuromuscular blockade, but the better to avoid head of bed more than 30 degrees, because this will increase the intra-abdominal pressure. Evacuate abdominal fluid collection, paracentesis as in cases of hepatorenal syndrome, percutaneous drainage. Eliminate intra-abdominal contents, nasogastric decompression, rectal decompression, bronchodilating agents, all of these targeting to decrease the intra-abdominal pressure. Collective fluid balance, avoid rapid excessive fluid resuscitation, use diuretics, hemodialysis when needed, colloids when needed. and organ support as needed, ventilator or vasopressors according to the blood pressure of the patient, antibiotic and septic patient. Actually, all of these are easy to be done, but what always missed is number one and number three, although they are very easy and may help in decreasing intra-abdominal pressure. Finally, Oxford Handbook summarize all what we said in this diagram regarding the risk factors, how to measure intra-abdominal pressure through the urinary bladder, and the classification of intra-abdominal hypertension and acute compartmental syndrome. Our home messages: intra-abdominal hypertension and abdominal compartment syndrome are common complications of critical illness whose risk factors are common in critical illness. Actually, most of our patients, by decreasing abdominal perfusion pressure and increasing venous congestion, intra-abdominal hypertension is under-recognized cause of acute kidney injury. And I want to stress on this point, under-recognized. Many cases are missed. We have to measure the intravesical pressure of all our patients, especially if they have acute kidney injury. Intra-abdominal pressure should be measured in critical patients with risk factor for intra-abdominal hypertension. And physical examination, this is very important. Physical examination has poor sensitivity. You cannot diagnose intra-abdominal hypertension or intra-abdominal compartment syndrome by palpation of the abdomen. You may not find dense abdomen. It is important to measure through intravesical pressure measuring or any other way of measuring. Finally, lowering intra-abdominal pressure and increasing abdominal perfusion pressure may ameliorate or prevent acute kidney injury. Thank you for watching this lecture. You will find this video on YouTube and videos of our other lectures, and the PowerPoint lectures are available at nephrotube.com. Thank you and see you later.